Good afternoon, everybody, and a very warm welcome to you from St. Angela's College in Sligo. We're delighted to be hosting this webinar on promoting diversity and inclusion in nursing and midwifery education. My name is Susan Carton. I'm a lecturer here in St. Angela's College in the School of Nursing and Health Sciences and Disability Studies. I run the Disability Studies programme here in St. Angela's, and I teach on the Bachelor of Nursing Science programmes also. I'd like to really thank the IUA group for devising this set of seminars. It's been a lovely experience connecting with our colleagues in Trinity College and reconnecting with our colleague Trace in DCU. Thank you also for our attendees for joining us today. Judging from the registrations, we have people from, I just getting a note there to turn on the subtitles. I beg your pardon. There we go. I beg your pardon. Sorry. Thank you for that reminder. Yes, I was just saying thank you to all our attendees for joining us today. Also, I can see from the registrations that people are with us from all over the country. So I hope wherever you are, you're very well and safe and happy and that you enjoy the webinar. So we're going to have four short presentations today and then we'll have a live panel discussion. To start off, I'm going to set the scene for the webinar by taking a look at the current status of diversity and inclusion in nursing and midwifery, both in education and in the profession. We'll then be joined by Olenka Amaru, who is a PhD student from the School of Nursing and Midwifery in Trinity College. So Ola is busy researching her for her PhD, and her subject is nurse-led care transition interventions for older people. But today Ola is going to share with us her experiences of being involved with the Athena Swan Committee in Trinity. Ola worked with Professor Vivian Ryan and Professor Maria Brenner in preparing her presentation. Professor Brenner is unfortunately not able to join us today, but she's with us in spirit, and Professor Ryan will be with us in the panel discussion. Following that, we'll have a joint presentation from Trace Danaher from Dublin City University and Dr. Dimple Walsh Gallagher from here in St. Angela's College. Trace is a lecturer in the School of Nursing, Psychotherapy and Community Health at Dublin City University. She is chairperson of the SSNDP, so that's Supporting Student Nurses with Disabilities in Practice. She's on that committee and also developed and works in the role of disability support lecturer for student nurses. And this involves linking between DCU support services, the students and practice. Dimple then is a colleague of ours here in St. Angela's. She's a lecturer, academic leader and disability liaison officer and researcher in St. Angela's. She's also the International Disability Expert Advisor to the Disability Midwifery Research Society. Dimple's doctoral research was on disabled women's experiences of pregnancy, childbirth and motherhood. Therese and Dimple are going to tell us about their work on disability support programme for students at St. Angela's and DCU. I'll be back then to share the learning that my colleague Carmel Jennings and I have gained in widening access for one particular group of underrepresented students. I'll finish up by exploring where we might go from here and what some of the recent literature is suggesting we could do to improve levels of diversity and inclusion in nursing and midwifery. And our final 15 or 20 minutes will be given over to the panel discussion. I'll come back and introduce the panel at that stage. Each of the presenters have kindly recorded their presentations, so I'll ask you to bear with me in the transitions between them. In terms of accessibility, we've tested the captions and they seem to be working, but if any of our attendees have any difficulty with them, please email me at scarton@stangelas.nuigalway.ie. My email is on your invitation as well, and I can send the transcripts on to you now. So I hope you enjoy our work.
Hello again. So in looking at the issues of diversity and inclusion, we want to do a little bit of scene setting and make sure that we understand what diversity and inclusion are together and that we're talking about the same thing. So diversity, as you'll be aware, are the refer to the personal characteristics that make us all individually different. And just to remind ourselves, these can be race, gender, identity, religion, age, sexual orientation, or education, for example. In the US, what I found in the literature was that diversity seemed to refer more specifically to culture, ethnicity, and race. In the UK, then, the narratives on diversity seemed to have relevance to all the underrepresented groups, not just culture and ethnicity, and often this would be written about in the using the term widening participation. Inclusion then, and inclusion is often spoken about in terms of frameworks for measuring it or identifying it. So how do we identify that it's happening, and how do we measure whether it's successful or not, or to what extent it's happening, and what steps to the steps that we need to take to ensure it individually? So kind of in our own minds, what do we need to do to get to an inclusive way of thinking ourselves, collectively, so together in a culture? How are we an inclusive culture, or how do we go about ensuring that? And then systemically in our institutions, so do our institutions have inclusive environments, and do they work towards that? So if you'd excuse me looking away, I'll just read from here from my notes. And this is a quote from Bleak, McWilliams and Smith. And they are out of Wisconsin in the US. And they talk about an inclusive culture is one that brings diverse perspectives into decision making structures at all levels. It allows for and celebrates differences as enriching, and it reduces or eliminates barriers to the full engagement of all. So I think we'd all like to work in that place. And why is it important that we look at these issues? Well, I identified three particular reasons that seem to be spoken about in the literature on inclusion and diversity in nursing. So number one was the obligation for nursing to contribute to a just society. And this seminar series, in fact, was the general theme is the contribution of nursing to contemporary Irish society. So it's appropriate to look at this from this point of view. But also, I suppose the idea is that we're looking at the influence that nursing has in society. And it's certainly true that we could can contribute to the building a better society by building a better profession. And when I say better, I'm quoting Lois Berry, who was a Canadian researcher, and she did a lovely study which was part of her doctoral research in 2010 in Canada. And she identified that embracing the possibilities of increasing its diversity and inclusion with the ultimate goal of building a better, stronger and more just profession and a better, stronger and more just society was a part of what her participants were interested in. Secondly, the expectation that excellence can be achieved without good levels of inclusion and embedded, you know, thinking around inclusion and diversity just can't happen. So again, excuse me referring to my notes here. First of all, Kerry et al., and these were out of Duke University in North Carolina. The Duke University seems to have done a lot of work on this. There's a couple of other people who I'll be quoting. And if anybody would like the references, just drop me an email and I will, I'll send them to you. No problem at all. So Kerry et al. Reported that several studies on the subject of diversity and inclusion in nursing point out that an organisational culture that values diversity and inclusion is essential for the achievement of high quality nursing education. Likewise, Bleak and McWilliams, as before, proposed that academic environments only become excellent when an inclusive climate is reached. Now, Berry also, when she was researching with nurse leaders and trying to find out from them, how did they put inclusive practices in place and how did they increase diversity in their institutions. So when she, a part of that involved her talking to them about why they felt this was necessary. And they had identified at some points a lack of tolerance for difference in the profession. And that wasn't simply to do with cultural or physical difference. It also related to a lack of tolerance for different ways of being and different ways of thinking. And they were reported, her participants reported that the profession expected and reinforced conformist thinking. So it's easy for us to understand that we won't make it to excellence if we continue in that vein, that we need to be ready for, to be open to change and open to new ways of thinking, and change is hard. It's hard for all of us. Anyway, third reason then that why this is so important is that public services really have to be representative of the societies that they work in. Public services are provided with public money, of course, so the population in that state deserves to be represented in the all of the institutions and all of those services. So, you know, healthcare, education, welfare, they provide a better service if the person going in to avail of those services sees people like them in there and people like us in there. So, again, back to Lois Berry's work, she notes that societies in the developed world are becoming increasingly diverse. And of course, we know this is only going to continue at a faster and faster rate as climate change makes large parts of the world uninhabitable. So this is going to continue. There's going to be no reversal. She also found that the nursing profession in 2010 when she did her work, it expected the members of the nursing profession to sort of represent the norm, and the norm at the time was white, middle class females. So that was what they were expecting, and they expected that that was what a nurse was. That's interesting, isn't it? And probably something that exists here in Ireland too. And again, back to Ralph, another group from North Carolina, who just noted that generally speaking, healthcare professions were very slow to change their demographic. It was quite a static group. So we have a couple of challenges to meeting this idea of public services matching the population, if you like. I hope you can see the importance of that. So one way to bring this home to me was, in my own experience and work, was to think about the groups that I interact with at work. So perhaps the various teams I'm on within our school, classes that I go into, and when we used to meet face to face, if I went to a conference, what would that look like in terms of representation of diversity? And probably the classroom is the place at the moment that there's the best diversity going on, best levels of diversity. Now, I also thought about the meetings that I go to, so meetings within the college or the university, meetings with our placement partners, and wider university meetings, and certainly probably a little more so here in the northwest of Ireland, the levels of diversity are low enough. And I want to just talk now about a little bit about what measure am I applying to that. So is the diversity that exists in the general population represented in these spaces? And for me, that answer was no. It may be different for you, it may be different for people in the larger urban areas, and I hope it is, and I hope it'll change for us too. Interestingly, in the UK, where there's a long history of diversity in the general population, Lee did a study in 2020 looking at the representation of Black, Asian and minority ethnic groups in the NHS and in nursing in particular. And they found that from band 7 nursing upwards, which is relatively, it is a relatively senior level of nursing, but the from band 7 upwards, the representation falls steadily until at band 9, the representation is at 3.8%. Now, just to put that in context, Lee was rehearsing in England and Wales. So in the national census, Black, Asian and minority ethnic groups represented about 14% of the total population. But interestingly, in the NHS, that rose to 20. So we have even larger than the national proportion working in the NHS, but yet still, as you move up the profession and get to the top of it. Now, that band 9 is, you know, the very senior posts at a national level, and usually they're consultative. But in those posts, the representation was much poorer. So what about up here in Ireland? I found it difficult to find statistics about diversity in nursing in Ireland, but if we even just look at the general population, so we know that 50%, just over 50% are women or women identifying, 13.5% are disabled people, between 5 and 7% are members of the LGBTQI community, and 17.8% are non-white Irish, and then 0.7% are members of the traveller community. And we, again, if we ask that question, do you see those proportions replicated in the profession of nursing or indeed in any of the professions, but we're interested in nursing today? And the answer is a resounding no. And the group probably that I have the most familiarity with are the disabled people in Ireland. So we have 643,000 disabled people in Ireland, so 13.5%. And I see that proportion represented or replicated nowhere, not in any public service or private service. So it is something that we need to address if we're going to get to a better levels of diversity and inclusion, which will make our profession better and will make the service that we provide much more closely aligned to the population we serve. So thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you enjoy the other presentations, and I'll be back with you in about 20 minutes. Thanks so much.
Hi everyone, my name is Olayinka Aremun. I'm a PhD student in the School of Nursing and Midwifery, Trinity College Dublin. I am in my second year technically, but I volunteered as postgraduate student representative of the research committee in my first year. And this gave me the opportunity to join the Athenas One. Today, I'm going to be sharing with you my involvement with Athenas One, my experience of being involved, and what I hope to influence, and some useful links and resources. So the Athenas One was established 2005 in the UK and extended to Ireland in 2015. The award scheme and charter founded on 10 basic principles and key commitments. You have details of that in the link there. So Athenas One has been known for recognition of excellence in work undertaken to address gender equality. Equality in this sense covers all academic roles, all disciplines, professional and support staff, including students, of which I am. The commitment of the Athenas One in the Trinity involves removing barriers in the school that contribute to underrepresentation, using a targeted approach to issues of internal and external origin. Athenas One supports and recognizes embedding of gender equality across all aspects of our work. I would say Athenas One challenged discrimination. Using this framework to tackle gender inequalities and a system approach to changing institutional culture. That's what Athenas One is about. So how does Athenas One work? So Athenas One work using a reflective self-assessment process to identify opportunities for positive change, develop and communicate good practice in order to promote transparency, and cross-school collaboration. It may interest you to know that in the Trinity at the moment, there are 8 undergraduate students and 17 postgraduate students on the 14 active AtenaSwan EDI committees. This calls for more. So the AtenaSwan basically has the self-assessment team, of which I am involved, to prepare application for award. And as part of the assessment process, student consultations and perspectives are taken into consideration, especially on the impact of local practices, systems, and culture on EDI. So let me tell you a bit of my story of why I joined Athena. As a fresh international postgraduate student, I experienced, you know, the social isolation, mostly due to pandemic, but this was worsened by the feeling of lack of sense of belonging and that invisibility. I felt like I was alone. I felt another sense of doubt. I felt like I was not significant enough. You know, all this coupled with the fact that COVID was everywhere. But joining Athena gave me my voice. Yes, if you see in that lovely sketch there, I can remember in one of the meetings in Athena, I was provided the opportunity to, you know, voice my experience, my challenges. And, you know, I felt like I was in an open culture. I felt like the atmosphere was free of bias and prejudice without, you know, any feeling of intimidation and less significant. So this was one of the reasons why I joined Athena. So what now? As I'm here to work with support of other members of AtenaSwan, providing representation for every other student, and also to engage other resources and significant others to promote representation, creating awareness and support for all students, irrespective of our color, our race, our gender, our class levels, on issues relating to equality, diversity, and inclusion for all. My involvement in AtenaSwan has actually opened up new conversations and opportunities for me, especially with the Trinity Inclusive Curriculum Project, which commenced October 2020. They actually have, you know, we share parallel interests when it comes to equality, diversity, and inclusion. You know, particularly this is talking about inclusion in education. So I'm going to be working together with the Student Partner Committee on aspect of training, workshops, stakeholders meeting, and consultative role when it comes to student involvement in Athena. So I'm going to conclude my presentation with this slide here, talking about you can't spell inclusion without you and I. It is very clear that we need one another. We need one another to promote equality. We need one another to promote diversity. We need one another to promote inclusiveness, especially when it comes to gender inequality. And these are additional links and resources that might be of use to you. And I'm going to thank everyone for this opportunity to listen to me. A special thanks to my friend from the North Sakaten, Rachel Ark, for the before and after sketch you saw in the presentation. I'm also going to thank every members of the AtenaSwan for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.
Good afternoon. This is Therese Danaher, and we're talking today on the topic Disability Support Programs for Student Nurses at St. Angela's College, Sligo, and Dublin City University. The introduction and the first presentation will be by myself, and the second presentation and the conclusion will be by Dr. Daphne Walsh Gallagher, St. Angela's College. St. Angela's and DCU projects are relative to today's seminar on diversity and inclusion in nursing and midwifery. Both St. Angela's and DCU have established specific systems to support student nurses with disabilities in practice. The support systems are there to increase student nurses' opportunities to have a more diverse and inclusive experience as a journey through their nursing BSc programs. The background. In 2013, I established a DCU committee named SSNDP, which stands for Supporting Student Nurses with Disability in Practice. We had 23 members initially from 11 partner services, DCU, Disability Learning and Support Services, and the School of Nursing. A collaborative and learning environment for all members were created, and students were invited to committee meetings when necessary. What helped the committee to advance to present stage? We consulted with all staff levels in practice. We developed our knowledge level as a committee with feedback reports at every meeting, educational seminars, and inviting guests to talk at our meetings. Meetings monthly initially, and sometimes twice a month when establishing the committee. We discussed confidentially and anonymously issues students have in practice within the meetings. This resulted in members returning to practice with new suggestions for reasonable accommodations to support students on placement. Now we have bi-monthly meetings as we're well established. Disclosed disabilities, examples at the moment of issues some of our students have at DCU: physical, diabetes, epilepsy, cerebral palsy, hearing problems, psychological, anxiety, depression, personality disorders. Now, cognitive issues, for example, dyspraxia, dyscalculia, and dyslexia, which is the highest issue we have, the highest number of students we have dyslexia. Now, examples of reasonable accommodation that are being used out in practice. Right, if it's a communication problem, sometimes giving instructions one at a time. Negotiate breaks can help, split shifts. Then documentation issues, quiet environment, well-lit area, screen reader, font size, electronic dictionary. Time management issues, handover template, daily plan of care, use of lists, and assisting with prioritizing. The outcomes of our committee to date: we've published guidelines for the student nurse, guidelines for the health partner services, other documentation, for example, like clinical needs assessments, reasonable accommodation forms, and then for when students disclose consent forms, both for the disability link lecture and the CPC. I also have set up a Loop SSND page, which is being used regularly by all staff, by students, and by DCU staff. This is an electronic teaching and learning platform. Summary: together we have changed and developed as a committee since 2003. That's now 8 years ago. Creating SSNDP was the key to our success because we shared and collaborated until our system worked effectively. Now, task we have is to update all our documents. Thank you. This is Trace Danner. And over now for the second presentation to Dr. Deborah Walsh Gallagher, St. Angela's College in Sligo.
Thank you very much, Trace, for that very informative presentation. Good afternoon, everyone. So as Trace has introduced me, my name is Dimna Walsh and I'm one of the lecturers here in St. Angela's College, Sligo, in the School of Nursing, Health Sciences and Disability Studies. So today I'm going to just talk to you about reasonable accommodations or supports and practice placements for our student nurses. Ensuring that St. Angela's College at their student nurses are appropriately supported while they're out on their practice placements very much requires a collaborative approach. And we set up a joint committee involving the School of Nursing itself, the practice partner services, all of them, the Disability Learning Support Officer within the college, and of course the voice of the student being heard at these meetings as well. And again, like DCU, we've encountered a range of disclosed disabilities, and they are supported with a range of accommodations, as you can see here from this slide. So to promote equal opportunities for all students in the practice placement environment and to optimize the student learning, the Joint Committee developed a 7-step guideline. And this 7-step guideline is introduced to each cohort of students, so from year one to year four in semester one. And we also make it available, including the forms, etc., that go with it, through our electronic teaching and learning platform called Moodle. Now, the seven steps that are involved in the process, I'll just go through them and outline them with you now. The first one would be to register with the Disability and Learning Support Officer. The second one, step two, is where a meeting would take place with the student and myself, the disability support lecturer, where the student then can discuss any concerns that they may have that pertains to their learning and assessment in the practice area. Consent is obtained then from the student, by myself, you know, to make contact with the designated CPC regarding the need perhaps for reasonable accommodations to be put in place to support the student. Step three then, with the student's consent, the designated CPC would inform the practice placement area that a practice needs assessment and a support plan perhaps are required for a student. Step four then, a meeting is then arranged with the CPC, the preceptor or their supervisor, the student, the disability learning support officer, and myself to identify reasonable accommodations. And then this information is recorded and it's concluded, and the student keeps record of it, as do we ourselves. Step five, if the preceptor or the supervisor perhaps were unable to attend that meeting regarding the needs assessment and the support plan that have been identified and concluded, then that would have to be communicated back to the placement area by the CPC. And again, that would be with the student's consent. Step six then, the evaluation and the effectiveness of the reasonable accommodation supports are continuous throughout the placement and post the placement as well for subsequent placements, just to ensure that they're being met and the student is happy with the accommodations, because they're not set in stone. We can reevaluate them with the student again and change or amend as necessary. Step seven then, if there was any change to the student's circumstances, or if they no longer perhaps wanted to avail of the reasonable accommodations or the supports and practice placement, they put that in writing to myself and they confirm that that is their choice. And then I would communicate that back to the team that was supporting the student in the placement areas. So from that, we can conclude then that both universities, DCU and ourselves here in St. Andrews, support student nurses with a range of disabilities. And with the flexibility of establishing these supports, that can be left up to each of the individual establishments. Mm. However, we both can concur that both colleges, both universities have the same outcome, and that is that we 100% support the student in their practice placements, and we do the best that we can for them to make the journey as enjoyable as possible for them. And we believe that all IUAs need to have a support system available to student nurses. This will help us all to comply with the legislation, and ultimately will lead to a more diverse and inclusive learning environment, providing equal opportunities to all of our students. And I'd just like to thank you very much for listening to myself and Trez's presentation. And thank you, Trez, as well, for working with me on this presentation.
Thank you too, Dimna. Pleasure to work with you.
Thank you, Trez.
Hello again, and thank you to Ola and Trez and Dimna for those presentations. So in preparation for this part of the seminar, my colleague Carmel Jennings and I had several conversations about our experiences of including one particular underrepresented minority in education. Carmel ran the Certificate in Life Course Skills for students with intellectual disability for 9 years here in St. Angela's, and I have run the Disability Studies courses in here for the last 11 years with my colleague Peter Kearns. Including disabled students here in St. Angela's has given Carmel and I an incredible opportunity to learn about the barriers to education for these students and what is required to ensure that they get access to the same college experience as everybody else. So disability studies started for me when I was teaching a module to the undergraduate intellectual disability nursing students, and the module was called The Nature of Nursing. And in this module I wanted to look at the kind of fundamental issues, one of which of course was what is disability. And in reading around to prepare for what we would be discussing in class, I discovered the writings of the disabled activists and academics, and it's not an exaggeration to say that my world was changed. So it really was my road to Damascus moment, mainly because I discovered that I was part of the problem and not part of the solution for disabled people, as I had always fondly believed. Now, the reason I'm telling you this is that it strikes me that for any fundamental social change to happen, the journey really does start with the individual. And there's no getting away from that idea that we need to do the work ourselves of examining what is happening here in terms of diversity and inclusion in nursing, in both the education and the profession. So in the case of disability studies, I was prompted to revise my thinking on almost everything I thought I knew. So how the world works, who's in charge, who made it so, and particularly at the time, why do we think the way we do about disability and impairment and disabled people? And the relevance for this seminar is that the issues that disabled people face in a lot of ways resonate with the issues that other marginalized groups face. So the dominance of the majority, the othering of people, and the discrimination that they face. Now, I'm trying to figure out how we came to that position of considering some people as other and different, and in a lot of cases lesser. It became apparent that the story has historical perspectives and religious perspectives, and it also is inextricably entwined with the notion of power. So our attitude to disabled people, for example, has been in formation in our cultures for centuries. So those classical ideas from ancient Greek and Roman times, for example, the idea of the healthy mind and the healthy body, are still continue to be highly valued today. And later on, in the 18th and 19th centuries, the scientific revolution and the industrial revolution that occurred in those centuries led to the belief that the actors in those grand social and cultural developments really must have been at the very pinnacle of human evolution. So I think people really were a bit delirious with themselves and thinking that they were absolutely marvellous. And the problem with that is, of course, that if you believe that yourself, and if you can make others believe that you are the very high point of the whole of evolution and you are the best thing that ever happened, you can do anything. You can invade, you can oppress, you can wage war, you can colonize, you can segregate, and you can make it all morally justifiable. So an example of this disability studies involves a lot of sociological studies. So the sociologists tell us that we're born into a world not of our own making, and this makes perfect sense. We learn about that world from our home environment, so from our parents and guardians and families and friends, and we absorb the beliefs and values of those around us. We may or may not be allowed to question that. We might be encouraged in that way or not. But these beliefs, and sometimes they translate into assumptions and prejudices, can be so deeply embedded in our culture and socialization that they assume the status of common sense. And as such, then, they are not examined and they are not questioned. So a small example of this from my own life, you may know this map. It's called the Mercator's projection. And in the house where I grew up, this map hung on the wall over the kitchen table. So I ate my cornflakes every morning with this in my field of vision, and in that way learned the shape of the world. I was quite pleased at the centrality of our little island on that map. Thought that was the right thing. That was the way it should be. So I was quite surprised then going into my friend's flat in my 20s and seeing this hanging on the wall. And she told me that this was Peter's projection and was in fact the actual map of the world. So the map that showed the world, the continents and the countries more accurately to their actual real size and their relationship to each other. So I had some questions. I didn't really understand how I had thought the world was one shape and it wasn't. And it also shifted my position in the world. So I wasn't too pleased about that. So I keep a Peter's projection map on my wall to remind me that what I believe may not be true and the assumptions that I make might have been made on misleading evidence. So if we're to address the issues of poor diversity and inclusion in nursing, we need to identify what the problems are. And Breslin and the other authors that I've referred to help us to do this. So Breslin say that higher education is failing in its attempts to address the diversity of our nation. The reason for this is that the student populations on the campus are the results of society's failure to embrace the concepts of diversity and inclusion, and the inability to see the need for more equitable distribution of resources. So in that way, the campus population becomes a mirror of the general population. People's biases and the cultural lens through which they see the world prevent them from seeing why systems that have served them well must change. Breslin and co. call the situation where diversity and inclusion are successfully addressed as cultural proficiency. And this is a step change from, up and away from cultural awareness and cultural awareness training, which do nothing to address poor diversity and lack of inclusion. So they see some of the barriers as that implicit bias that exists in all of us. This bias sometimes leads to a presumption of entitlement. So we think we're entitled to what we have. Also leading to systems of privilege and repression and that unawareness of even the need for change, let alone not wanting to do it, but you don't even know it's necessary. And this is it's obvious that if you're in a situation of privilege, you're not going to be looking to change anything, or you're not going to be prompted to change anything. Bleak also talks about this and says that nurse educators who have been socialised to Eurocentric values may hold a worldview that is more exclusive than inclusive. So in America, usually when they're talking about Eurocentric values, they're talking about white values. So where to from here? Well, luckily there are some solutions. And again, all of these writers have proposed some. But just to say that the first part of starting something new is saying goodbye to the current ways of doing things. That's probably the first important thing. And that personal work on our own beliefs and values is essential. That because it brings us to those fundamental issues of who we're open to, who we're willing to be influenced by, and who we'll be willing to receive ideas from. So these are the indicators of openness to diversity. So in terms of what we could do about it, we could aim for cultural proficiency. Now, this requires intentional systems approach, as all good change managers will know, and commitment. The writers also had some practical ideas about recruitment, so that perhaps we could consider recruiting student nurses not only on the basis of their points in exams, but we may need to consider other avenues for recruiting students from these minority groups into the programmes. Now, of course, we have our examples of that here in St Angela's. We have our wonderful Access programme, and I'm sure examples of those exist in every university where non-traditional students are encouraged through you know, to come into the programmes. So maybe the idea would be to increase the numbers for those or increase the places for those. Accreditation is an interesting idea in that it puts it recruits the governing bodies and asks them to write in standards for us that we would need to meet. So, for example, it might mean the NMBI, the Nursing and Midwifery Board of Ireland, writing into our requirements and standards that students need to be placed in environments where there is good there are good levels of diversity and good inclusive practices so that they can learn there. Visibility is about giving in education, about giving our students from diverse backgrounds some of the visible roles. So in the Students' Union, representing students on councils and committees, and maybe, you know, being class reps or these kind of things that just push up their visibility a little bit. Communities of support, there's a very nice description in one of the articles there about that, what they did, and they created film clubs, book clubs in the days when we could meet, of course, coffee mornings, where students could get support together, and also they were great places for learning for among everybody, with everybody mixing together. And finally, retention, which probably referred more to staff than students, but making sure that minority staff were being made permanent and progressing up the promotion ladder if that's what they wanted. So definitely some solutions there for us that we could be thinking about in the future, and plenty of food for thought. So thank you very much again for your attention, and we will go directly to the panel now, and I'll just come back and see you live in a couple of minutes. Thanks so much.
So if I could ask the panel members to come on, and I'll just introduce you as we go through. So I'm hoping also that you're, for the attendees, are you able to contribute to our chat? Please feel free to come in and make any comments or ask any questions. But our panel, we have our presenters, and we're also joined, Professor Vivian Brady's here. And when the panelists come on, you might just introduce yourselves if I haven't already. Carmel Jennings is with us as well, who's a colleague of mine here in St Angela's College and a lecturer on the BSc and ran the life skills course, as I said. Peter Kearns, I see there also. Hi, Peter. And Peter is joining us from ILMI, that's the Independent Living Movement of Ireland, which is a disabled people's organisation. And by that, I mean an organisation run by and for disabled people. Peter is also, in his spare time, a very important colleague of mine and has been my mentor for 10 years. And none of our disability studies courses in St Angela's would be what they are at all if it wasn't for Peter. And we have Philip White, who's with us also from the Access course here in St Angela's College, an Access officer and coordinator of the Diploma in Foundation Studies. And of course, Trace and Dipna are with us as well. And we have a bit of technical support there from Paul. And just, I don't know whether Michael Drummond was able to come in there, but Michael is the president of the Students' Union, so he may be able to come and join us later on. So for the panel, if you'd like to switch on your mics and any comments, I'll keep an eye on the chat here. We haven't, we just have a comment from one of our, just at the start, from Mel, just looking forward to the event. Thanks for that, Mel. And then if any of the rest of the attendees would like to ask anything, but I might just ask for comment from people. And Peter, I might start with you.
Great to be here. Just looking forward to the panel discussion. Just because I I tried to get cured. I got different medication, different operations. Went to do it twice, but I have to get, it can't be cured. I'm going to have it for the rest of my life. Just say, I'd like to apologize for my government actions. It can't be cured. It's not cured. So,
done your best.
I went to do it twice. I thought I would get a bit more French accent after that. But do ask me any clarification you want to do on the panel discussion as well. I'm delighted to be here. I'm wearing two hats, although no hats in my head. I'm the social inclusion manager of a course broader project to the independent movement. I'm also a permanent part-time lecturer with St. Andrews on the disability equality BA and master's program, and also on the ID nursing program as well. My second student was back in 2008, wasn't it? And through that we've done quite an exciting journey, really exciting journey. At the time, there was no disabled persons organization. IMI only started in 2018, but I was working for the Disability Quality Special Support Agency. And my student contacted me to look at setting up the degree course. And through that, we started along. Long and ongoing into future relationship about linking the St. Angela's undergraduate and postgraduate, especially in master's, with the disability equality approach. I'm quite delighted to say, and thanks to you for giving me the opportunity that we in the college are the only disability quality markers in the country. It's very important to say that. And a lot of the modules are quite new, they're quite unique, even not only in the Irish context, but also in the international context. So I'd be quite happy to chat about the role of disability quality in how we got here and where we're going with the future. So, hopefully that's okay. Hopefully you understood the role of my German acting. So thanks, guys.
Thank you, Peter. I just have in the Q&A question here. I'm sorry, I don't know if that pop-up is appearing on your screen there. So this is from Mel Hibbert. She's the founder and director from the Intersectionality Network. What about implementing accountability? What will be the consequences of targets not being met? And Mel, I presume you're referring to, you know, if we were able to figure out ways of setting goals and standards for diversity and inclusivity. Would any of the panel members like to address that? Oh, Vivian, great.
Hi, my name is Vivian Brady. Lovely to join you all this morning. And Mel, I just... You know, I know certainly from Trinity's perspective, we have, you know, various strategies, inclusion and diversity strategies and equality reports and so on. But I do know from the Athena Swan perspective that Ola spoke about there, that if we don't meet our targets in terms of Athena Swan, well, then the universities will suffer from a lack of funding, because I know that Athena Swan is one of the pillars of the National Equality Strategy, and funding from Science Foundation Ireland, the Health Research Board, etc., are really contingent upon securing Athena Swan awards. So apart from, you know, what Susan was talking about, our moral ground and how we need to be, you know, in nursing and midwifery, consider, you know, just our just, you know, lens, our excellence lens, as Susan referred to, and our inclusivity, you know, being part of the public and being accountable to the public. Apart from all of that, from a financial perspective, if we don't start meeting our targets in terms of diversity and inclusion, then the universities and the ITs will suffer as a result of lack of funding. Certainly with the team as well.
Just jumping in, thanks for not only in terms of money, but also in terms of the UN Convention. To tell people that's going to have bigger teeth now, generally, and that will be also dictating. That's our own suggestion. We'll be dictating numbers, and especially around terms of disability, equality, and intersectionality, that around class and gender and ethnic background. So that will also have an impact on effective inclusion too.
Thanks, Peter. Yes, there may be some examples of those that we could, you know, weave into these systems whenever we get them, sorted. That, because Mel is absolutely right, unless there is some accountability, things do fall apart. And this, we need to take this out of the aspirational, you know, we'd love to do it, or just, you know, stopping at the mission statement or the vision statement, and really get it into practice. Anybody, I'm just interested to talk to Philip there for one second also. Philip, just about the access course, for example, that seems to be in the literature, it seems to be very highly valued in terms of creating access for underrepresented students.
I suppose the thing about access is that it because of its focus, it means that our policy is to reach out and create an environment for students, and obviously whether they have a disability, whether they come from an ethnic minority, and we would have a good track record in respect of that. I suppose what it does as well, it gives them the confidence to engage in education, and then prepares them for when they then make that transition onto undergraduate. And I suppose we can sort of identify any supports that they need before they hit undergraduate level. And then the idea is that those would then, there'd be a continuation of those as they go on to progress. In relation to, for instance, either those from minority backgrounds, when I say minority backgrounds, obviously they could be Irish citizens from minority backgrounds, but also a lot of students who maybe are coming through, or refugees are coming through the asylum process. We've had a lot of students from those backgrounds, and what we identify is that we can get them through the access program, but then there is a massive ceiling which stops them progressing, normally based on their status. Mm-hmm. And the idea being that they can get through an access program, but then they're faced with huge international fees and stuff dependent on their residency. So I suppose what we've tried to do is we've tried to, through the Widening Access and Participation Committee in St. Angela's, is to identify funds to provide a scholarship for one student from that type of background, which actually allows them to progress, in this case through the ID nursing degree, with financial backing. And then the second thing we did was we provided a bridging funding for those students who didn't qualify for SUSE or the alternative to SUSE, the new system which has been set up through the Department of Social Protection. So it's just those things that really sort of like take away certain barriers, which allow students to get that opportunity that they wouldn't otherwise get. So I'm quite because I work in access, I think it's the most important thing in the world, and I sort of think that it's the key to sort of providing a level playing field, basically, which clearly when it comes to third level there isn't at the moment, because if there was, then obviously the numbers would be much higher. And as somebody said to me, genius is spread across all constituencies, but opportunity is not, unfortunately. And that's the key.
So true.
That's the key.
So true, Phil. Thank you very much for that, Philip. Teresa, I apologise. I see your hand is up now. I apologise. Come on in.
Right. No, just listening to everybody there and listening to all the great ideas. Sometimes I come overwhelmed with the fact that there's so much we have to do. And it's still important to realize we are chipping away at actually having universal design and having an area where learning is actually more amenable to people. I suppose when you look at even the panel today, some of you are talking about what the staff needs as well as the students, then you're looking at the different aspects. So I think sometimes I feel, oh my goodness, I'm not really doing enough. But I think we should take pride in what we have done. And I suppose the other issue I'm only thinking about in our own place in DCU at the moment, we got the award recently of being the first university, not alone in Ireland, but internationally, its title is an autism friendly university. So, and that is through our Professor Mary Rose Sweeney's work with regard to, she set up a project a couple of years ago, and that project has really taken off. And it is really helping people that arrive onto the campus, and that's including student nurses, including staff as well, with different from different perspectives of the spectrum. So there's lots going on, and sometimes in our own campuses we have to go searching to find all the good that's actually there, not a mind hearing what's happening in St. Angela's today and happening with this one the tennis one in Trinity and whatever. It's great to open up our minds, listen to everybody's opinions today and their suggestions and the great things that are going on. Over to you.
Thank you, Trace. Thank you for that comment. And I'll come to Peter now in one second, but just to say, Mel just came back there to say to Philip about, wait, I just get the comment properly. Philip grants and accessing postgraduate is also important. And Mel is asking what measures will be implemented to safeguard people with intersecting identities from discrimination while in higher education. Thank you, Mel, for that. Oh, and Carmel is saying her sound is gone. Sorry, Carmel, does that mean you can't hear us? Peter, would you like to come in there?
Yeah, just kind of pick up on what Mel said. It's something that's very important to me, not only in terms of my, as an actor for the past since 1980s, but also as a lecturer in academia, but we are talking about academia here, that if we don't start off and see the new person disability here, the map is showing different maps, how that can completely topsy-turvy the thoughts into a whole new domain. So when we don't, in terms of academia, if we don't agree on the bedrock of what we mean by disability, there's a chance that some academic experience might go separate ways. So what I mean by that is that if we keep a medical model approach to disability, if I medical model approach, I mean, take myself, I have the label cerebral palsy imposed on me. I didn't pick that. 50 years ago, it was spastic. I can call it spastic. So that's the label of Paul for me. So if academia gets too caught up in impairment labels, we know that those impairment labels can cancel out everything else. It can cancel out an overshadowed gender, class, ethnic background. So we do have to apply an academia disability equality approach to say that we don't fall in the trap of responding to impairment labels. I mean, we all know those impairment labels change over time, and that's static. So I don't identify with the impairment labels, so apologies, that changes. It's a clinical label that changes over time. So, but I think there's a there's a definite need from across the Irish academic institutions to come to some kind of agreement on disability equality approach to students accessing academia and recognizing that not alone the impairment is able to overshadow class and gender backgrounds.
Thanks, Peter, for that. Let me just, I just want to check there. Did I say that already? I might have. What measures will be implemented to safeguard people with intersecting identities from discrimination? And Mel just making the point there, correct language is very important, absolutely. And we can only learn that from the people themselves, from the target groups as such. I'm just aware that it's 1:07 and I know that some of our attendees may need to leave, and indeed some of our panelists. I'm quite happy to stay on and chat a little longer, and Dimna has her hand up there, so just Dimna, you come on in there.
Thanks, Susan, and thanks everybody. I think as Trez said, I've learned so much as well in relation to what's going on in other universities and DCU, Trinity. Vivian, let us know that, there's a lot of supports going on there for students as well. But I think it was quite timely, Susan, that you had up the map of the world, because I think we are, all of us are on a journey, but at least we've started the journey and we have moved, even from listening to Peter there, having the diagnosis even changed. I know, Peter, it has to change a lot more, even from, maybe the initial spastic to cerebral palsy, but we're on a journey and I think we're all working really, really hard and trying hard. And I think as Professor Vivian has said there, supports even financially, hopefully we'll be going now a bit further on our journey. But I know for myself, I've learned loads, and I just wanted to thank everybody. All right, thanks.
Thanks very much, Dimna. And I'm just looking at some of the comments here. I'm sorry, I appear to have missed a few along the way. I apologize. So Ola was also just commenting there about the agreeing with Philip on issues with access and support for minority groups. And there are a few people just commenting. Our head of school here, Evelyn, just thanks for the webinar. And Ursula, and then, Melanie was popping in her Melanie's details there are in the chat as well. There was a couple more. Liz Hartnett there, I see, had commented just on the SSNDP, just to say how wonderful it is over there in DCU, absolutely. Many thanks for the interesting presentations. SSNDP is a very important resource for many nursing students building on their nursing competence in DCU, absolutely. Ola, sorry, I see your hand is up there. Come on in.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for this opportunity. I just wanted to say, I know from the presentations and from all the comments, I'm actually thrilled to know that a lot of work is going on in the background for minority groups. It's just the aspect of, I'm opportune to be here. Like, that's why I could know this, but I feel like other students how they might not know that there are work on the ground, in favor of them, in support of them. So I think a little bit of more visibility and, coming out to, so that people will know what we are doing at the background, and we'll create a kind of awareness and people will be glad. Thank you. Thank you so much.
I think that's really important, Ola, that visibility aspect is just so key to getting to better levels of equality, and it's really important, and we need to work on that to find ways to make that happen. Thanks very much, Ola, for that comment. Carmel, your hand is up there as well.
Yeah, just thank you, everybody. And Susan, I found your presentation brilliant. And all the presentations were brilliant. But just going back to the cultural proficiency, I think that, and Ola has mentioned that there in relation to visibility, I think that needs to be kept on the agenda within the universities, and particularly within nursing, that we look at those things, Susan, that you identified: recruitment, accreditation, visibility, support, and retention. and we have a way forward, and that we should keep the conversation going and actually work on it. I think we've an awful lot to do when you look at the statistics. We're very white middle class, still very much, you know, when we look at our statistics. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Carmen. And Vivian?
Hi again. It's just very brief, really, just to say that, you know, the students, they're such a rich wealth of information and so interesting. And we talk all day, every day, and people, I'm sure, are fed up listening to what we have to say. So it's wonderful to have Ola on board here today, and wonderful to hear you, Susan and Carmen, referring to ways to get students involved, you know, class representation, journal clubs, all those things that, you know, to support students in using their voices. And certainly, you know, when Peter, I'm sure, comes in to give his lecture in disability studies as an academic lecturer with you there in Sligo, I'm sure the students really sit up and pay attention, because we're here, we have the user, the lived experience. It makes such a difference, makes it so rich and so relevant and accessible for students, which is really refreshing and encouraging. So I really hope that work continues. It's really important work, and really encourage students to speak out and get involved. And the grassroots, I think Mel mentioned grassroots earlier in her comment or her chat. I think that's so important. And I think that's what's recognised certainly in policy and strategy in our school anyway, for sure. So thank you.
Thanks, Vivian. Anybody else like to comment, or we might aim to close out now at 13 minutes past one? Everybody okay with that? All right, just remains for me to reiterate how lovely it was to put this together and to work with our colleagues in Trinity and DCU. Thank you for all the hard work. I should also, of course, have mentioned Sean Kelly here in St. Angela's is our marketing media genius, and we couldn't have done without him. Thank you so much. And I also had great technical and admin support from Dawn McGuinn and Pat Moffat. And I had some technical support from Paul Slattery, who's down there at the bottom deciding not to come on. So thank you all for that. And I look forward to the next in the series of seminars, which I think is happening after Christmas. Thanks very much indeed.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.